This video is made possible by G Suite by Google Cloud. It's all the things you love from Google, Gmail, Docs, Drive, etc., but designed for business. More about G Suite a little later in this video. Like many inventions versions of an airplane, black box were independently invented by several people, in this case beginning around the 1930s or 1940s. As for the version that began being installed on commercial aircraft, it was invented in response to a tragic loss of life. A de Havilland Comet 1, the world's first commercial jet-powered airplane, disintegrated over India in early 1953. Of the 43 passengers and crew members, none of them survived. Australian chemist Dr. David Warren joined an expert panel looking into the cause of that crash and two other crashes involving the Comet 1. Australia had a vested interest in the success of the Comet because of its possible use by Australian Airlines for a route between Australia and the United Kingdom. While Dr. Warren was an expert in fuel research, the plane crashes resonated with him for another reason. His father died in 1934 when the plane he was on crashed into the ocean off Australia's southern coast. Investigators never discovered the cause of that crash. Warren's part in the investigation of the Comet accident led him to believe that a simple voice recorder located on the plane during the crash would have saved the investigators time and energy trying to determine what went wrong. He said, "If a businessman had been using one of those in the plane, and we could find it in the wreckage, and we played it back, we'd say, we know what caused this." Warren drew on his background in electronics, experience he gained from building crystal sets or unpowered radio receivers in school, and he created a prototype of the ARL Flight Memory Unit. This device recorded both conversations in the cockpit and a small number of instrument readings for up to 4 hours of the flight. Once the 4-hour recording time had been reached, the recording device recycled and recorded over the oldest information. While the unit, which was named after the Aeronautical Research Laboratories where Warren worked, showed success during flights conducted by the Australian Department of Civil Aviation, the Australian government and military failed to show further interest in the device. In 1958, a British official visiting Australia learned of Warren's flight memory unit and invited him to England to continue his work on the device with scientists and manufacturers. It soon went into production in England and in the United States before being installed in aircraft all around the world. Australia actually became the first country to require all turbine-powered airplanes weighing over 12,500 pounds to have one of these devices on board. So, how did the ARL Flight Memory Unit become known as a black box? Well, that's actually a bit of a mystery, especially considering that within the industry it is almost never called this, and the devices themselves are a color called International Orange, which allows them to be more easily found at the site of a plane crash. That said, the first known instance of these devices being called a black box was very early on at an Aeronautical Research Council meeting in August of 1958. The man who called it that is one E. Newton, and why he did so isn't definitively known. As such, there are a number of hypotheses about how the term black box came about. One states that the name came from the fact that the boxes were often blackened and charred from fires that happened during the crash. Given the first known instance of someone calling it this was about the time Warren was invited to England to further his work on the devices, which is before they were widely installed on planes, this seems rather unlikely. Another, much more plausible hypothesis is that it's a holdover from World War II, where the Royal Air Force used to refer to various experimental devices put on planes, such as the Oboe targeting system, as a black box. It's also very possible that it comes from the engineering practice of calling a system that takes input, does something to it, and then spits something out, a black box, specifically when what happens in said black box is unknown. Either way, the nickname was and still is particularly popular with members of the media, while aviation experts almost always refer to them as flight data recorders. As for modern black boxes, they've undergone a number of improvements over the years, though the basic thing they do is essentially the same as the original. Specifically, they consist of two separate devices, the cockpit voice recorder, or CVR, and the flight data recorder, or FDR. The CVR records all of the noise inside the cockpit. That includes the conversation between the crew members, radio transmissions, any alarms, the sounds of the controls being used, and even the noise from the engine and the air moving around the plane. Today, CVRs record a total of 2 hours of audio before the newest audio recording writes over the oldest part. VFDR records a variety of flight data, though the exact requirements depend on things like the age and size of the plane and what sort of equipment is on board. However, all black boxes are required to record, at a minimum, the pressure altitude, indicated airspeed, magnetic heading, normal acceleration, and microphone keying. The final term, microphone keying, here lets investigators match the data with the CVR recording. While the FDR records on the same endless loop principle as the CVR, it records a total of 25 hours before overwriting the oldest information. Black boxes need to survive the impacts of the crash along with any fire that might occur afterwards if they are to be of any use to investigators. While the requirements of a black box sometimes change after a crash, generally they are required to be able to survive circumstances such as a 1,100 Celsius fire for an hour, 33 kilometers a second squared of acceleration for 6.5 milliseconds, about what would be produced in a crash at 310 miles per hour, and being immersed in salt water at specific depths, among other specifications. The placement of the black box at the tail of the plane also raises the likelihood of survival, as the tail section doesn't usually bear the brunt of the crash impact. Additionally, a locator beacon is included, which can also help investigators find the black box if the aircraft crashes in water, as it emits a pinger signal for at least 90 days. Thanks to relatively recent accidents like the Malaysian Airlines Flight 370, a variety of upgrades to these systems has been suggested to take advantage of modern technologies, including decentralizing the box. Further, instead of just having an onboard recording, add in a system for live streaming in real time of the data that it's storing to a central database on the ground. That way, even if the onboard recorder can't be located, such as when the plane itself can't be found, the ground crew still has the data they need to analyze what caused the crash, and along with the broadcast coordinates, they can even more accurately start looking for the plane and any potential survivors. So you might not be dealing with such critical data as a black box in your business, but I bet you still think that data is quite important. Now, you've probably heard of Google. They seem to make everything. Just making this video, I've used Gmail, Drive, and Docs, and probably several others that I'm not even remembering. G Suite is basically the for-business version of all of those products that you already love. And it's amazing for businesses of all sizes. We use it a lot here at Today I Found Out. Indeed, it is pretty critical in keeping everything running smoothly. One of the biggest benefits I found is that you can use Gmail to manage your email, so I can have an email address that ends in @todayifoundout.com, but it works like Gmail instead of some horrific 1990s email browser that web hosts seem to force on you. Then there's the ability to create multiple Google calendars that you can share easily with other people. It's way easier to organize stuff than just with the free one from Google. Plus, you get lots of extra space on Google Drive, plus you get extra security, plus you get management and other businessy things. And it's also super affordable. Look, if you're running a business of any size, make it easier with G Suite. We do. It's got huge benefits, super low costs. Just do the same as us and try it out. You'll find the link below. And now let's get into some bonus facts. Have you ever wondered the best way to survive a plane crash? Well, wonder no more. You gotta sit in the back with the cool kids. According to several studies, passengers near the tail of the plane are about 40% more likely to survive a crash than those in the first few rows up front. The other advantage is that most passengers choose not to sit in the back, so unless the plane is full, you might get the row of seats to yourself. However, other research into surviving plane crashes indicated that those passengers who sat more than six rows from an exit were found to be far less likely to survive. So, if the plane does not have a rear exit, that's something you want to factor in. But if you do happen to fall out of a plane at 35,000 feet and you don't have a parachute handy, Popular Mechanics does have some advice on how to survive that fall. To quote them, "The concept you'll be most interested in is terminal velocity. As gravity pulls you toward Earth, you go faster, but you also create drag and eventually acceleration stops. Depending on your size and weight and other factors, your speed at that moment will be about 120 miles per hour. This takes about 1,500 feet. At about 22,000 feet, you sputter into consciousness. Hypoxia had knocked you out shortly after you exited the plane. Take aim. Glass hurts, but it gives. So does grass, haystacks, and bushes. And trees aren't bad, though they do tend to skewer. Snow? Absolutely. Contrary to popular belief, water is an awful choice to cushion the fall. With the target in mind, the next consideration is body position. To slow your descent, spread your arms and legs, present your chest to the ground, and arch your back and head upward. Relax, this is not your landing pose. To land, assume the classic skydiver's landing stance. Feet together, heels up, flexed knees and hips. And now for another bonus fact. According to the Geneva-based Aircraft Crashes Record Office, between 1940 and 2008, there were 157 people who fell out of planes during a plane crash and without a parachute and lived to tell about it. A full 42 of those falls occurred at heights over 10,000 feet. One such incident involved a British tail gunner whose plane was shot down in 1944 during World War II. He fell over 18,000 feet without a parachute. His fall was broken by pine trees and soft snow. After his landing, he found himself completely fine except for a sprained leg. Things didn't initially improve for him, as he was quickly captured by the Germans. Apparently, the Germans were more impressed by his near-death experience than his nationality, because they released him the following May after having given him a certificate commemorating his fall and subsequent survival. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below, and don't forget to subscribe. Brand new videos just like this every day of the week. And don't forget to check out G Suite by Google Cloud. Find a link to that below. And as always, thank you for watching.